All right, given that we have quorum, I will call the meeting to order, and Commissioner Donahue will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag and the republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Could we have a roll call?
Commissioner Donahue?
I'm here.
Commissioner Meeks?
Here.
Commissioner McKelvey Day? Commissioner Monzo?
Present.
Commissioner Ramos?
Present.
And Chairperson Gonzalez?
Present. Welcome, one and all. We'll go ahead with staff introductions.
Destiny V, Administrative Aide?
Courtney Grossman, Planning Manager.
Lisa Brinton, Community Development Director.
Loretta Blair, Planning Manager. Sean Morrison, the planner.
Great. We'll open it up now for public comment. Are there any comments from the public regarding items that are not on today's agenda? Seeing as there are none, we will continue with approval of the minutes from our last meeting, which was October 18th. Any questions or comments from the commissioners regarding the minutes? Is there a motion and a second?
So moved.
Second motion.
Great. With a motion from Commissioner Donahue and a second from Commissioner Meeks, we'll have a roll call vote to approve the minutes.
Commissioner Donahue?
Aye.
Commissioner Meeks?
Yes.
Commissioner Monzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Ramos?
Yes.
And Chairperson Gonzalez?
Yes. All right. Looks like we have no administrative reports. Is that right?
Correct.
And no considerations for today. We'll move on to our one and only public hearing, which is a recommendation to adopt the 2023-2031 housing element, which will be included in the general plan amendment. And Grant Leonard, Planning Manager, will present a PowerPoint for this project.
That's right. Good afternoon, Chair and Commission. Grant Leonard, Planning Manager, Advanced Planning. Very excited to be with you today to discuss our final draft 2023-2031 housing element and the associated general plan update for that. We've been working on this for about a year now, and we last came to the Planning Commission in May with our public draft. And we've been busy over the summer refining that and finalizing it. And the presentation today will give a little bit of background, talk about the goals, policies, and actions, and then the next steps to get this adopted and finalized next month. So very quickly, the housing element is part of the general plan, and it establishes the city's goals and policies for all things housing. It is updated every 8 years, and this is the year to update. So we're due to have it done by December 15th, next month. And it's very important, not only just as a visioning document and goal setting document, but for funding. It's required to have an adopted and certified city housing element in order to receive certain funding from California Department of Housing and Community Development. So understanding this very important project, we wanted to be sure we had robust community engagement. And here's a slide that details some of our efforts, including holding three public workshops on the draft in the spring. Those were robustly attended, and they also had interpretation services, not just for Spanish, but also for indigenous language as well. We also partnered with the Center for Community Advocacy, CCA, on a grassroots approach to community engagement, with community ambassadors holding house meetings, over 100 of those, and engaging with over 340 farm workers. Really wanted to reach communities that might normally be involved in this kind of governmental process. And again, that was with not just Spanish translation, but also indigenous language outreach. We also participated in over 40 city pop-ups for the budget, and housing was consistently listed as one of the main priorities for people throughout the city. So we took that engagement and we used it to help form the new housing element. We really put it into action. And you'll see the next couple of slides discuss the main goals and priorities that the community listed that are now reflected in the housing element. So the first one is really just about producing more housing. You know, we have a low supply of housing within the city, and so we need to increase that supply and make sure that it's available for everyone throughout the city. So some of the actions we can take is to incentivize production, working with developers and development community, working with property owners to encourage more accessory dwelling unit production, and making sure there's a diverse type or diversity of housing types. One bedrooms, two bedrooms, studios, single families, multifamily, and of course accessory dwelling, because we really need the full suite of housing options in order to tackle the housing crisis. Another key priority for the community was tenant protections. Salinas is a majority renter community. So I want to be sure that we have policies and programs to prevent displacement of renters, that we have tenant right programs developed, and that we provide education opportunities and connect tenants with legal services when there is a landlord-tenant issue. Also, we have an aging housing stock within the city of Salinas, much of it over 50 years old, and with that comes needed maintenance. So we have a goal to ensure access to safe and healthy housing, make sure that rental housing is in good quality and good condition, to promote maintenance and rehabilitation of existing housing through reestablishing our grant and loan program for low-income homeowners, and promoting healthy and sustainable housing. So getting rid of things like lead paint and asbestos, making sure that your home is a safe place to be in. And of course, we need to work with our affordable housing development community. So we have here efforts to advance housing affordability for all income levels, including moving forward with rent stabilization. The city just had a presentation on that from the city attorney. Working with our affordable housing developers to facilitate more production again. Connecting residents to financial resources so first-time home buyers can get into the housing market, get a good down payment. And providing assistance to special needs populations like the seniors and disabled within Salinas. A fifth goal was really to support our neighborhoods. We have a beautiful, vibrant city, and we want to protect that community character, so we can collaborate with residents on neighborhood improvement projects, such as the More Salinas program featured here. Work with our code enforcement department to ensure that there are no code violations that are degrading our community and our neighborhoods. Support historic preservation so that we maintain our city's rich history. And we're doing that with our Historic Resource Board. And work to reverse patterns of segregation or discrimination, such as by implementing the LSL Vibrancy Plan and the Chinatown Revitalization Plan. And the last goal that was really a top community priority was making sure we have adequate homeless services and programs. And we'll do that by implementing the countywide Lead Me Home 5-year plan to reduce homelessness. We're enhancing our street outreach team. The city recently received over $8 million to support that effort. And we'll facilitate more shelters and transitional housing units, such as through the Home Key program, which is featured here with the picture of the Goodnight Inn. So that's the broad picture of what the goals, the policies, and actions are for the housing element over the next 8 years of this planning cycle. On the technical side, the reason we have a general plan amendment is because the housing element is part of the general plan, so this update will require an amendment. And really what we're doing here, we're just finding that it's consistent with the current general plan and that it's necessary to comply with state law. We're also completing a California Environmental Quality Act analysis. The current approach is to complete an addendum to the 2017 Economic Development, EIR, and that's because that was the last citywide environmental document, so we could tear off of that. But simultaneously, we're also considering determining that this housing element is actually exempt from CEQA, and that's because there's no required rezoning through this process. So we're looking at both options right now, And on December 5th, a final determination will be presented to City Council. Which brings me to our timeline. So since May, we finalized our community outreach in June. We submitted our draft to the state for review in July. And they had 90 days to review, but they actually did a speedy review for us and got comments back by August, which allowed us to do a second draft of our housing element, incorporating some of their initial recommendations. We then received a final recommendation comment letter from HCD on October 4th that's included in your agenda packet. And that encouraged us to do a little more refinement of our site selection for housing sites, to do some more robust analysis of impediments to housing production constraints, and also to do some more analysis for furthering fair housing. And we met with state officials last week as we issued this updated draft, talked through our changes, so things are looking good on that level with state review. The next steps is the Housing and Land Use Commission at the end of the month will receive this presentation, and then City Council will adopt housing element on December 5th before the statutory deadline of December 15th. The state then has 60 days to review it, and the city staff will be authorized to make non-policy changes to the document. So if we need to tweak a number here or there, it's not substantive to the actual goals or the actions. We'll do that with HCD. And then our deadline to have it certified to make sure we're fully compliant with state law is April 15th. And with that, the recommendation before you is to approve a resolution recommending the City Council adopt the 2023 housing element and general plan update, and then authorize staff to submit it to the state, and authorize staff to make any non-policy revisions recommended by the state. And with that, we're open for questions and comments.
Any questions or comments, Commissioner Donahue?
Nothing at the moment.
Commissioner Monsell?
Yes. So I asked this at the last meeting. I just want to make sure that I'm clear, but reconciling like the current general plan and the new general plan, so essentially we're adding it to the current one, but then we'll be adding it again once the new general plan is updated, or how does that work? Because for it to be consistent with the general plan.
Yeah, good question. So currently we're operating under the 2002 general plan, so that's the amendment that's before you. And then we're scheduled to adopt a new Vision Salinas 2040 general plan in summer of next year. So this amendment will make it consistent with the current general plan, and then as we publish the draft general plan next spring, it'll have this housing element as part
already
of it.
Included.
So it'll be already baked in. Yeah.
Okay, cool. I thought something that was really interesting was just like the pieces around race and ethnicity and just kind of breaking down the composition of like integration and segregation. And I was just curious, because I saw that the city of Seaside wasn't something that was included in that, like what the composition looked like. Is it because the data wasn't available, or it was too small of a city to think about the data, you know, in terms of the regional trends?
You know, I'm not sure on a reference to the city of Seaside.
Okay.
So I'll have to look that up and get back to you, if that's okay.
Yeah, just because I thought it was really interesting because we know that there's a larger Black community there, and so I was just curious to make sure how that kind of fit into the regional trends of like race and ethnicity and kind of how we were moving. So, okay. And then I know that, I feel like I know the answer to this, but I'm still gonna ask. But I know that there were some notes around like community meetings talking about community land trusts as a potential option for, you know, meeting the housing needs. I'm assuming that nothing was particularly baked in terms of like policy or actions, because it's something maybe that's more on, you know, externally that's built, you know, together. But I know that there are other cities that, you know, where they either give land or give funds, right, to a community land trust. I guess I'm just thinking about the foundation that's set in the housing element for a potential for that in years, you know, because I only found notes about a community land trust, but no real mention besides that. So my question is, Why was it not included? And is there a sufficient foundation for a potential support for the city in the future because there's notes included that was part of the conversation, if that's something that comes up in the future? Because I'm thinking long term.
Yeah, definitely. I think our approach there was to have it be more broad referenced in Chapter 6, so support exploration of community land trusts or work with community partners on researching it, just because it's a new topic at this point. So we wouldn't have a definitive policy of implementing it within, 3 years or something. It's more of a foundation of, yes, we're interested and we're going to work with the community to explore it further.
So you would say there is probably enough foundational information to be able to build on it later in the year, later in years if it comes as an option, right?
Yeah, we'll build on it within the next 8 years of this planning cycle.
Cool. Okay. Sorry, I'm looking down my list. So also I like the pieces around rent stabilization because we know that that's what folks are continue to ask about, right? Seems a little long, 2025, but I know that there's a lot of research that has to be done before something is being implemented, but at least there's a close enough date that we're working toward. One of the questions I had is, I know that we're operating under the 2017 Inclusionary Housing Ordinance. Is there a potential, could or would there be a potential for updating the Inclusionary Housing Ordinance in the future, to see if it still complies and if it fits, in terms of our, current economic landscape, what the development landscape looks like?
Yeah, definitely. I believe that's actually under contract now. So we're working with economic analysis analyst firm to update that background study, and then an updated ordinance will be coming forward after that.
Do you have a timeline for that?
Director?
I do not. We can get that for you, but I do believe it is 2024.
2024.
Probably mid-2024. I think it has been delayed. But it was actually, I think, initially requested that we come back December 2023, and that was a little aggressive for staff resources as well as the consultant capacity. So it is still in motion, and I believe called out, as a policy implementation to continue to update it.
Okay. Okay, that's good to know, just to make sure. And then I know that one of the objectives is to preserve 39% of affordable housing stock at risk of conversion. Can you talk to me a little bit more about what that means? Is it, how does that, I know it's working with folks to ID the stock. How does that work to know when something's at risk and that you want to grab it right away? I'm a little confused about what that looks like.
Sure. So affordable housing is affordable by deed restriction. So when it's developed, there's a clause attached to its deed and recorded to the county. And in the past, that would often be for just 30 years or 10 years or 50 years. The best practice now is to have it be indefinite, in perpetuity. So you track it by establishing your list, and then in 5 years, so many of those 30-year deed restrictions will expire. And then you work with the owner of that to extend or to purchase an extension. If they receive state or federal funds, such as a housing authority, that'll automatically convert to in perpetuity. So it's really just tracking those deed restrictions and then working with the property owner to extend it once it gets close to expiring.
Okay, so then the staff already has an inventory of what is coming up. Okay, great. Okay, that makes more sense. Thank you. And I think my last question is around the rental registry. I know that one of the bigger concerns was the inspection piece, and I know there's language in there around a safety net. And I guess my question is what the timing of implementing the inspection program is. Is it until a safety net is created? Are they happening, simultaneously? What does that look like? Because I know that there's a big reason why rental registry is great to be able to figure out and make sure that people are living in suitable conditions. And I know that one of the big concerns was what if they don't have anywhere else to go? What does that look like? So I think I'm curious about the timeline and if that's happening concurrently or if we're waiting until we have a safety net in order to do it, the inspection program.
Yeah, excellent question. Another program that's already launched. So we're in the early phase of taking rental registrations now. Our housing department's leading that effort. And I'll defer to Director Brinton on what the next steps are for any kind of inspection for it.
We are just focusing on the registration program and working out kinks with that and getting compliance. And then we will have the data that we will need to know, okay, what is our rental stock? And I would say best practice would be to wait until we have a safety net. We're not going to charge into implementing an inspection program without having resources to offer in terms of legal services, financial services. That would not be a best practice. So we would want to be very intentional about the timing. And at this point, there is not even any planning for the inspection component. It's still on the radar, but we want to get the registration piece right first.
Okay, perfect. I think those are all my questions for now.
Thank you. Any questions, Commissioner Meeks?
Yes, I have a couple. First, how do you determine what is or isn't affordable housing?
I'm sorry, how do we determine?
How do you determine what is or is not affordable housing?
I'm sorry.
I know of a place right now where the housing is doubled in cost. The same unit now costs twice as much as it did a couple months ago.
Okay. Yeah, so, you know, affordable housing, there's a couple of definitions. One is what you can afford, which is kind of least useful. Then there's the general metric of you should never spend more than 30% of your income on housing. And then there's the legal definition, which is in deed restricted property for someone within a certain income bracket. So when we refer to affordable housing and the housing element, we're referring to that legal definition. So properties that are deed restricted to people who earn 40, 60, 80% of the area median income. And that's separate from the average rental market, which is not regulated, and mm-hmm. you know, you have to work with your landlord, other than what's regulated by the state and the Housing Protection Act of 2018, which is 10% maximum rent increase annually.
But this is more than 10%.
So there's an enforcement issue with AB 1482 and education piece. So tenants may not know their rights. And so that speaks to our goal here of increasing our education efforts for landlords and tenants.
How do you intend to promote rehabilitation of housing?
Well, there again, that goes with our community development block grant program and reestablishing our homeowner rehabilitation program. So that's a grant and a loan program. So you would apply to the city for your house to be repainted or to get a new water heater or to have your windows replaced or your roof repaired. And if your income qualify and your application's complete, then a contractor will come out, do the work, and it's paid for through the city grant program.
I have two more questions. One deals with leveraging code enforcement strategies. From my point of view, where I live, I don't think they're doing a very good job. How do we convince them that they need to maybe pay a little more attention to what's going on?
Sure. So again, this might be a question where Director Brenton chimes in, but I know our code enforcement officers had been understaffed. They're now fully staffed. And
yeah, but that's the excuse for everything.
It's a common theme. But it is also a complaint-based system, so we need to be notified of an issue and then the officers will respond.
And one time we were told, this commission was told, if we can't see it from the street, we're not going to enforce it. I don't think that person's still there, but it's just a comment.
Okay.
And last thing I got is, could you give me a better idea of, where is it? It says reverse patterns of discrimination. Are there any particular areas of town that are have a problem with that?
Yeah, so again, that by the state definition for affirmatively furthering fair housing, the neighborhoods within the city that qualify for that are the Alisal, Chinatown, and then areas around downtown here. The older housing stock and some income segregation and some racial issues as well. So by implementing the Downtown Vibrancy Plan, the Chinatown Revitalization Plan, the Alisal Vibrancy Plan, we're going to be reversing that trend and investing in those communities.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any questions, Commissioner Ramos?
Yeah, I have a couple. I appreciate these questions because that checked off some of mine. But I'm going to... I'm a teacher, and I'm the new guy up here, so I'm playing catch-up. and housing goal number one, increase housing supply. Does that mean there's plans to build more homes, or are we working with what we have now, or both?
So it's both. There are plans for new growth within the future growth area north of Baronda Road. So there's an adopted west area specific plan and an adopted central area specific plan. And then city staff is leading the effort on a third growth area that's called the east area specific plan. And we're just kicking off that process now. And in total, those three areas will account for about 12,000 housing units over, you know, 20 to 30 year build out period. But then we also have redevelopment opportunities within the city. So sites that are underutilized or could be converted, adaptive reuse projects such as Rabobank or the Bruin Building. And then we also have individual property owners who want to add accessory dwelling units, you know, granny units in the backyard. And so our policy here is to support all those efforts and to encourage individual property owners to pursue it or developers to come to Salinas and work on development proposals.
Excellent. So this brings up another question. I don't know if it can be answered here or if it's a different department. Like I said, I'm the new guy. So that's great to hear. But what about traffic and roads? You can't build homes without thinking about, the congestion. Oh, you mentioned Baronda. It's crazy. So is that a whole another department that will come and do a presentation that's going to go along with yours, or is this something that you can answer?
Yeah, so first of all, welcome to the commission. It's always good to have a new person, so appreciate your service to the city. Traffic circulation, very important. I'll give a two-part answer here. One, the maintenance of the roads is through the Public Works Department, and they've given some presentations to City Council on their plan for that. That's updated every year. And then in terms of future growth, such as with the housing developments and specific plans, that'll come through our department, and we're working on that through the general plan update. And the circulation element in particular focuses on how to accommodate more growth and how to solve the congestion we have currently. And actually just tonight at 6 p.m. at the Salinas Police Department Community Room, we have a general plan steering committee, and we're focusing on our circulation element tonight. So a very timely question. Certainly happy to provide specific information to you, or if we want to do a general plan update to the commission, we can do that and focus a little bit on traffic and circulation.
Yeah, I don't know about the rest of you, but I would appreciate that because I live in that site, and year after year it just gets crazy. And now they're building the soccer complex, which is another whole thing. They're expanding and doubling it. So I personally would love to have that information. And then my next question has to do with housing goal number four. It's an extension of Mr. Meek's questions, facilitating protection of affordable housing. So I look at the word affordable in terms of, I'm in education, I'm a teacher. So a brand new teacher at our district, they start at 56,000. So would they be able to look at these, the housing and say like, oh yeah, with my income, that definition of affordable fits for me, or not?
They would. So the income categories are updated every year by the federal government, the Department of Housing and Urban Development, and also the state, the Community Development, HCD, Housing and Community Development. And they take an average of the incomes throughout the area, and then they issue, you know, what's 100%, what's 80%, 60, 40, and $50,000 a year or so would qualify as low income by those standards. So for affordable housing and the legal definition, yes, a teacher would qualify for affordable housing.
Okay. So going with the affordable part, I know there's different levels, right, of homes. There are extravagant homes, beautiful homes, and there's homes that, you know, a first-year teacher could say, like, oh, well, I can afford that. I don't know if you can answer this, but as far as looking into the future, what of everything that's being built and constructed and all that, what percent would you consider to be affordable?
Yeah, so that's kind of a complicated question. I'll give my best answer. So the city's inclusionary housing policy does require a certain percentage of new homes to be deed restricted as affordable if the development is over, you know, 6 units or 10 units. So that percentage of every major development will be deed restricted. And then the new growth areas will feature a mix of houses, so a single family home, but also multifamily homes, so new apartments, new condos. And then what makes it more interesting, a little trickier to answer, is that as you have new growth, that will then make the existing housing stock, you know, you'll increase your vacancy a little bit as people move into new homes, and then potentially the rent or the cost of the older housing will fall compared to the cost of the new housing. So through future growth, you could also see your existing housing stock become more affordable.
Okay. Thank you. No more questions.
Thank you. Let's see. I also am grateful to all the questions that have come before, and I think I just have a few to build on those. One is when the, because I know this is just sort of a pit stop on the way to the city council, are they going to receive the same info that we're receiving?
Yeah.
Will they, because what I don't see included is the list of themes from the community engagement so that they have something to kind of like compare what are the new changes to the housing element vis-a-vis the themes and what you all learned from this robust community engagement. Can they also receive those themes as some?
Yeah, definitely. Those should have been included as an attachment to the staff report.
I think it is in the house. Sorry to interrupt, Chair Gonzalez.
Please do.
It's in the element, but I do think it would be really cool to add it as part of the presentation.
Oh, definitely.
You know, like I think that it's something really important because you all did really robust work that I think it would be a really important point to make.
No, excellent. We can do that for sure.
Thank you. Okay, my notes are all over the place. Just a quick follow-up on the inclusionary housing process that will start in 2024, mid-2024 possibly. Just wondering what happens in mid-2024 and how long is that, what does that process look like?
I think it would, through the chair, we could schedule a presentation, an update at the next Planning Commission meeting to give an update on that timeline.
Great.
Because I don't want to speak incorrectly.
Thank you so much.
But we can come back and answer those questions.
That would be wonderful. Thank you. And then, when in under housing goal one, and this is, I'm sure this is indicated somewhere else, but when encourage diverse housing types, what are some examples of diverse housing types? Does that have to do with the size of the units and the number of units?
Yeah, exactly. So it's size. So smaller units like studios versus one bedroom or not just building 3 and 4 bedroom McMansions. It's also the type of housing, so single family, but also multifamily, or accessory dwelling units, and then also junior accessory dwelling units where there's actually part of your home which is separated off and you could rent out.
Great. And then to follow up on the community land trust piece, I think, you know, a lot of cities are learning that just affordable housing or just rent, we need a really robust strategy for preventing displacement. And so one of the strategies that is part of that comprehensive solution set is community land trust and the partnership between community groups and the city. So it's good to know that that's included as something to look into. And two of the things that I think cities can do to support that is assessing what public lands can be made available to such projects, and then also facilitating access to capital. And so wondering if this housing element lends to those kinds of supports.
You know, I think it does. Actually, there's a state law that requires all jurisdictions, cities and counties, to list surplus land that it could be available for housing. It's the Surplus Land Act, and we comply with that. And then in terms of pursuit of capital, we do have several programs and actions related to identifying grant funding and working with developer partners So, you know, a good example would be Moongate Plaza here in Chinatown that was redeveloped with MidPen, and the city partnered with them and helped secure funding, et cetera. Or the Share Center, which was funded through the state and the Homeless Emergency Action Program, HEAP funding.
That's great. In terms of providing tenant protections, will the city and make capacity available for collecting data on, like, identifying what are some key indicators to understand tenant displacement, housing insecurity, and be able to measure those indicators over time and see how, so that we can measure our improvement around that issue?
Yeah, I think so. You know, we have our existing data sources, the census, et cetera, but with the rental registry coming online, that'll have a richer source of data for us to compare for, you know, how long people are in one place, what their rent is, et cetera.
Great. It would be great for some of these key community groups to be involved in that, groups like CCA or BHC. I just wanted to follow. I was really appreciating the questions you're asking, Commissioner Ramos, around, like, what do we mean by affordable? I know it's been a real concern within the community that, you know, things that are designated as affordable housing aren't actually affordable for our working families. And so I heard you clarify that, yes, a teacher making $54K would qualify, but would the cost of that housing be more than 30% of that person's income? So would it actually be affordable?
Yeah, you know, depending on the presentation, we actually have the slide that lists the current income levels. And then correspondingly, there's what your rent is based on your income. So it is in that 30% range.
Okay, great.
To clarify, Grant, that's for deed restricted properties that are deed restricted as affordable.
Okay, yeah. And I know there are issues with deed restricted housing, and I don't know if we can get into that right now, but that is a, I'm not sure what the issues are, but I have heard that that could be a, we don't want to just rely on affordable deed restricted housing as a solution, because that, there are issues with that. And so just making sure when we're saying facilitate different kinds of housing, that there are other options besides just that, which is, deed restricted. Is the city looking into other options to ensure housing stability as just deed restricted?
Yeah, so I'll just chime in. You know, the deed restriction is, again, for you have an actual legal restriction on it to cap the rent that can be charged on that unit. But they're also affordable by design. So building a smaller units, encouraging development of multifamily and apartment. And just by having that variety of housing stock, you'll have lower rents for certain units.
I think some examples, you know, by design are live-work units, condos, townhomes, that by design, smaller footprint, then lower cost.
And then just, I know that some cities have done, agricultural communities have had programs for first-time home buyers specifically for farm worker families, and is that something the city's looking into?
You know, we do have two policies in Chapter 6 related to farm worker housing. I'll double check to see if there's a specific home ownership program for farm workers, but definitely a good comment.
You were saying?
I'm saying I don't think so. I think it's like for five families, but I don't think it explicitly calls out farm workers. I did a little bit of homework, sorry. My brain's like,
thank you for doing that.
That's okay. You know, it's a big document. It's like 250 pages before the appendices are added, so I don't expect all of us to remember every word.
I think my last question is, so great to see work to reverse patterns of discrimination. Thank you for the question about that and your response in terms of what does that actually look like. It's the investment in specific neighborhoods that have been experienced disinvestment. And then just this is the city thinking about how to make sure those investments in those neighborhoods actually benefit current residents and don't contribute to further displacement? That's one of the pitfalls of reinvestment.
Yeah, you know, I think that part of it goes to the name, right? It's the LSL Vibrancy Plan or the Chinatown Revitalization Plan. So these aren't gentrification plans. These aren't urban renewal plans. These aren't moving out the current people to move in new people. It really is about investing in the community. And you'll see that with the implementation of the LSL Vibrancy Plan and our small business coordinator who's working with the businesses there and the planning efforts that are going into the community parks, et cetera. So it really is about working with the community, grassroots, and not moving anybody out.
Thank you. All right, are there any other further questions or comments from commissioners? Commissioner Donahue?
No, no questions.
Commissioner Mansell?
Just a small request. I know that you said that there are some foundational pieces in there for the work around community land trust, but I only saw like notes from meetings, but no actual language around working. So if you can just point me in the right direction, because you know, you said, I trust that you said there's foundation there, but I would love to see the exact pages. Doesn't have to happen now, but just after this meeting.
Yeah, we'll do.
Thank you. Any follow-up questions or comments, Commissioner Meeks?
I have a comment. It's about the city of Salinas itself. I don't know which agency deals with it, but they need to be commended for what they did to Carr Lake. If you haven't been by there lately, drive by. Cleared out all the trees, cleared out all the homeless. It's you can see there's a lake there for the first time in 25 years or more. Yeah, they deserve a commendation. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions or comments, Commissioner Ramos?
No more questions.
No more questions for me. Thank you for all your work. All right, so, yes, any questions or comments from the public regarding this item?
Good afternoon, I'm Eloise Shim. So I know that Mr. Leonard, he used to work in Monterey City. And I was curious to find out, because I know that there's a lot of pushback with the rental registry in Monterey from landlords. They're not really on board with it very much. And I was just wondering, here in Salinas, I know it's fairly soon since it's been implemented here, but I wanted to know kind of like how many landlords have really complied with the program in terms of all the landlords that are in Salinas, how many have complied, and if they are also sort of pushing back, not wanting to do it.
Thank you. Great question. All right. Would any commissioners like to make a motion? We will. Oh yeah, any other comments from the public? Seeing as there are none, we will close public comment. And now, would anyone like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve a resolution recommending that the City Council adopt the 2023-2021 housing element general plan amendment and authorize staff to submit that element to the state and the HCD for certification, and then authorize staff to make non-policy revisions in response to those HCD comments.
Second.
All right, with a motion from Commissioner Marshall and a second from Commissioner Meeks, we will have a roll call vote on this item.
Commissioner Donahue?
Aye.
Commissioner Meeks?
Yes.
Commissioner Monzo?
Aye.
Commissioner Ramos?
Aye.
And Chairperson Gonzalez?
Aye. All right, we have approved a resolution recommending that the City Council adopt this housing element, which is an amendment to the general plan, and we authorize staff to submit this housing element to the state, or the council will do that vote. And the Planning Commission's action on this item is a recommendation to the City Council in support of this housing element general plan amendment. And staff will schedule the matter for the City Council's consideration, at which time a final decision will be made. Thank you. Moving on to other business, which is the General Plan Steering Committee update. I don't believe we have, do we have new updates? And would that be me and or Commissioner Donahue? We've had a steering committee meeting since our last, yes, and we reviewed a number of items. Do you want to start off our?
All I know is I'm going to be at another one tonight at 6.
Me too. yes, we were able to review one item focused on economic. Or no, we didn't review economic development, but we reviewed land use, which had a lot of economic development implications, and a lot of the questions that arose were related to economic development, and so I think we may come back to some of those pieces so that we can see the interconnections between some of these key elements. Staff also shared with us the updates to the art, youth, and community element that were made as a result of previous engagement. That was really helpful. And then we reviewed one other, which was?
There was some, and I left it, but they talked about public safety too.
Oh yes, public safety. And some exciting developments there within the public safety element, looking at a diversity of ways of addressing the issue of public safety. And I know one of the questions I asked and one of the suggestions is to make sure to review the recommendations made by the Department of Justice and make sure, see if there are opportunities to have that be reflected in the safety element. Anything else you would add, Commissioner?
No.
All right. Anything else you would add? All right. Thank you, staff. Looks like there are no follow-up reports. Do we have any future agenda items?
Yes, the next meeting we're looking at is December 6th. This would be an amendment to the master PUD for Northridge Mall. It's construction of about 3,000 some odd square foot fast food restaurant. It will include deviations from the sign regulations, and it will be on December 6th.
Thank you. Who will be able to attend the December 6th meeting by a show of hands?
Not sure.
Okay, so looks like we'll have quorum, the four of us. No, do we need five or four is good?
Four.
Four, okay. Anything else?
That's it for me.
All right, meeting adjourned.